Hey guys, this is David Kwan, and in this video, I'm going to talk about Metro 2033, which is, to me, is a coincidence that Metro: The Last Light, which is a sequel, was released just a few days ago. It's a total coincidence to me because I didn't know about it. I was just playing Metro 2033 via online like a month ago, and I finally finished it 3 weeks ago, but I'm finally here recording a video where I'm talking about it. It's an interesting game. I feel like many gamers consider this as like a cult classic. It's a game where a lot of gamers are like, oh man, there is this really underrated, underappreciated game that you need to check out. It's this awesome game called Metro 2033. It's based on a book. I feel like that kind of sentiment is pretty common to find among gamers who played this game. It's really understandable. And it has an interesting premise, you know. It's the setting is this post-apocalyptic setting, but it's a very realistic post-apocalyptic setting. Imagine, you know, if the Cold War had, or maybe a little before the Cold War, a nuclear bomb dropped off in Russia, and people kind of, before it blew off, a lot of people escaped to the underground subway bunkers and survive. So Russia is now this total nuclear wasteland of radiation and mutants and such. And these groups of people are living in the underground metro system and eking out a living. And it's their story of survival and trying to survive in this world. That's the premise. It's really awesome. The vibe you get is really awesome. And it's always nice to kind of, it feels unique to play in a game that's not set in America in a post-apocalyptic setting or in a totally sci-fi universe. It's set in Russia, and it's gritty, it's atmospheric. I think that's probably the thing that gets people to really enjoy Metro 2033. To me, what's wrong with Metro 2033 is I'm not, you know, and you can already tell by now that I'm not a big fan of Metro 2033. I really do not like this game that much. I kind of, I don't know, the overall vibe I get, you know, after I played through it, my overall conclusion of it was, meh, don't know why I had to play through all that. It was just kind of, so let me explain the biggest issue I have with this game. The biggest issue I have with Metro 2033 is that I feel it's so scripted. I'm not against, in some cases, I'm not against games being scripted or being extremely linear. I like linear games. Feeling scripted and being linear are kind of two totally different things, but even feeling scripted is something I don't mind as much if it's done quite well. So there are three games I kind of want to mention that does these kind of scripting things really well. Uncharted, of course, is a good example, and Uncharted does it so that you have these set-piece moments that, you know, just kind of just really shock you and wow you, and through it all, it builds on to the characters that you are playing with, which is Nathan Drake, and that the non-playable characters that Nathan Drake interacts with. It's a very character-driven kind of experience, and it builds on that. So set-piece moments makes you more kind of tied to this universe and its characters, which I think is great. Maybe sometimes it can be a little overdone, especially when we get to like Uncharted 3, but it's scripting makes sense here. Also, Call of Duty is one of the master games of scripting experiences. And they work because these moments are just ridiculously explosive, action-packed, and super fun. Call of Duty games, you know, they get a lot of flack, but they are super fun. The gunplay is tight, responsive, and you know, the set-piece moments are just freaking awesome. They don't really serve a story purpose a lot of times, except in certain games, Black Ops, like, I think that was a really very well story-driven game. But they're there to kind of just be really fun to look at, fun to play. And that's the scripting that Call of Duty does. And then you have games like Bioshock and Bioshock Infinite, which use scripting to push a narrative forward. A very compelling and awesome story. Story-driven experience, and it uses these scripting moments scripted moments to pull you into the story, into the universe of the game. Great examples of how, you know, scripting can be done. Metro 2033, unfortunately, does none of these things. It's based off a book, so, you know, you would expect it to have a great story. It doesn't. The story is kind of flimsy. Also, doesn't have any great characters either. Most of the characters just come in and go right back out after a level. You have these companion characters who you travel around with and fight with, and then after you play through the level, they're gone. They either die, or they leave, or you leave them, and their purpose, for most part, is like they open the door for you, Call of Duty 4 style, and then you go in, and you follow after them, and you trail after them. I don't like that at all, and that's what makes it so super scripted. And there are no like huge, gigantic set piece moments with these scripting scenes. It just is a very linear scripted moments. There are a bunch of Unreal segments. You know, when you get inside a tank-like thingy and you're manning the turret gun, or you're inside a cart and you have to move around and shoot your gun, a lot of Unreal segments. And if you know anything about me, when it comes to first-person shooter games, I hate Unreal segments. My least favorite thing about any first-person shooter game is when they do Unreal segments. It was definitely my least favorite thing when I played Killzone 3. It had too much Unreal segments in there. I suck at it. That's the first reason why. And also, I just don't like feeling this restricted. Especially in a game like Metro 2033, when the premise is about a nuclear wasteland in Russia. This game could have been such a great, awesome game if it had a more open world feel to it. And let me explore and not be bound by a checkpoint system. If it allowed me to save anywhere, anytime, like Fallout, or if it had areas which were for saving that I could backtrack to, like games like Silent Hill and Resident Evil, which are survival horror games, that would have been really cool. But no, instead, I have checkpoints. And because there are checkpoints, that pretty much means that whenever there's going to be a big fight or there's a lot of enemies ahead, I'm going to encounter areas where I can pick a lot of ammo and a lot of oxygen masks, making the experience very predictable, very scripted. And just totally boring to replay ever again. I have no intention of replaying this game, and actually just going through this game was kind of boring for me. And that's a shame, because it has such a great premise. It has a lot of great mechanics, too. One of the coolest mechanics that doesn't really reach its potential is the ability to buy and sell weapons by using bullets as currencies. There's two types of bullets, and you can actually use those bullets to fight enemies. They're more powerful bullets, but you can use them for currency. Very interesting mechanic, except the problem is that you don't get these currencies often. It's really hard to collect a lot of currency, a lot of bullets, and also coming across shops in which you can buy items is also rare. I think I ended up buying just one awesome weapon in the entire game. Maybe I bought some items here and there, but that was it. And maybe that was all I needed, but feels kind of a waste when you have this awesome mechanic and you don't really allow the player to use it. And that was a big problem. The other problem is with the gameplay, with the gunplay itself. It's really loose. Maybe it was designed that way, but if it was designed that way, then if that was intentional, then the biggest problem is the fact with the enemy AI. Not the monsters or the mutants, but the human AI. If you played any of the older Splinter Cell games, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You're stealthing through, and then you're sneaking through a level. An enemy discovers you. That one single enemy discovers you. And the entire room full of enemies now knows exactly where you are, and they start shooting at you, and their aim is nearly perfectly accurate. Imagine that, and most of the game is really dark, especially if you're underground in the metro system. And stealth is just really, really frustrating in this game. The gunplay is super frustrating in this game, especially against human enemies. It's not a very fun game to play, to shoot with. It's not a very fun first-person shooter. It's a tense survival horror game at times, but it's not a very fun first-person shooter. The shooting is not fun in this game. And I understand why. It was not intended to be like a first-person shooter like Call of Duty, even though it has a lot of elements of Call of Duty. It's very weird to me. So those are my thoughts on this game. I know I sound really negative on this game, but I don't know. It's not a game I really enjoy. I don't think it's a great game. I just think it has a great vibe, and I really think it's a cool thing that it's based off of this really cool book. I think that's really cool. But the game itself, I think, could have been much, much, much better. I don't know. Maybe I haven't read too much about anything about the sequel, Metro The Last Light. It seems like it's turned out to be a great release. So maybe if I end up playing Metro The Last Light, I'll have different opinions about this series. But as it stands, after playing this game, it just... Not a big fan. Cheers.